Next.js have just launched a brand new way to do server-side mutations called server actions. There are three different ways you can trigger these functions, so let's have a look at how each can help clean up your code and make it more secure. Probably. Servers are more secure, aren't they? So let's get into it. Firstly, let's run npx create-next-app and then the name of our application. So in this case, reading. We're going to build an app to help us keep track of all the things we want to read, like blogs, etc., so we can come back to them later. And this is going to step us through some questions. We can leave the defaults for all of these, but feel free to opt into JavaScript if you feel more comfortable with that. I'm going to use TypeScript. I'm going to use ESLint and Tailwind and no source directory. I'm going to use the app router, and I don't want to customize the default import alias. And once that's finished, we can change into that directory and open it up in VS Code. Now, server actions are currently in alpha, so we need to opt into using them. Let's open up the next.config.js file, and under experimental, oh weird, app directory is now stable, but the experimental flag is still set to true. I'm probably just gonna leave this one here and just append server actions and set it to true. Now we can install Supabase so we can query some data. So let's run npm install or I at supabase/supabase-js. And now that that's installed, we can just run npm run dev to start our development environment. And I already have a Supabase project up and running. Again, a super simple schema. I have one table called readings. And for each of our readings, it's a good name. We have a title, a URL for the article or whatever kind of resource we want to link to, whether or not we have read it yet, so this defaults to false, and then some upvotes so we can rank its importance against the other readings. We also have RLS enabled for the readings table, but for this example, we've just written a policy to allow all actions, so any request to select, insert, update, or delete will automatically be allowed, so make sure you click that link above if you want to learn a little bit more about RLS and how to write authorization correctly. So back over in our Next.js application, under app and then page.tsx, we can get rid of all the boilerplate that we're returning here. So from main all the way down to the end of main. And we can also get rid of this import for our image. And we're just going to return a h1, which says readings. And we can see that's working so far by going back over to the browser and navigating to localhost over port 3000. And we see our heading for readings. So let's get some data displaying. If we go back over to our application and create a new utils, and then in that a file called supabase.ts. And in here, we're going to export a default call to the create client function, which comes in from at supabase/supabase-js. And this function is going to give us a client, duh, allowing us to send queries to Supabase. So this function call takes in our project's URL and our anon key. So let's create a .env.local file at the rootmost part of our project. And in here, we're going to create a next_public_Supabase URL and also a Supabase anon key. And we can get these values from our Supabase project by going to settings and then API. And then this is our URL and our anon or public key. And then back over in our supabase.ts file, we can replace this URL with process.env.next_public_supabase_URL. And then the same for our anon_key. And we'll see TypeScript is not happy here because these environment variables might not exist. So we just need to use an exclamation mark to say that this value will exist in every environment this code is running in. Now we can save this one and head back over to page.tsx. And now because this is a server component, we can make it an async function, and then we can get some data, which is going to be our readings. We'll get this by awaiting a call to Supabase, which comes in from our utils/supabase file. We want to fetch data from the readings table, and we want to select all columns. We can now update our return statement to return a fragment with our h1 in it, and a pre-tag using this json.stringify trick to pretty print our readings. And if we go back to the browser, we can see that each of our readings are displaying correctly. Now we can add a match filter to our query to Supabase to make sure we're only getting back the readings where isRead is set to false. And we're still going to see our three rows here, but that's because isRead is set to false on all of our records. So if we go back over to Supabase and go to the table editor, and then click on our readings table and look at the row for this Next.js blog and change the value for the isRead column from false to true. And then we can save that record and see that it has changed in the database. Now, if we go back to our application and refresh, and you can see it's gone from our list. Now I'm going to set this one back to false again because I don't want to run out of data too quickly. Now we're going to iterate over each of these and display them in a list. So we probably only care about the ID, the title, so we can display it in our list, and then the URL to link to so that we can actually go off and read this article. So we can specify those columns in our select statement here. So we can say ID, title, and URL. So now we just see the data we actually need for rendering rather than going and just fetching everything. So back over in our code, rather than just pretty printing this out to the page, let's actually map over each of our readings. And then for each reading, we want to render a div, and we'll set the key prop to our reading.id. Then we'll have an a tag with a href set to our reading.url. And as the text for our link, we want to display our reading.title. Now when we save this and check why TypeScript is not happy, and that's because this might be null, and so we can just use optional chaining here to say only map over it if we actually have an array of readings. Now if we save this and go back to the browser, we can see we have each of our readings printed out to the page. So this is looking a little confusing without styling. So let's take advantage of the fact that we already have Tailwind configured and do some basic styling. I'm just going to copy and paste this one to speed it up a little bit, but with our H1, we're just making it a little bit bigger and a little bit bolder, and then pushing anything underneath it down a little bit with margin bottom. And then with each of our reading divs, we're adding some padding and a bottom border just to give it a line underneath each one with a gray that's fairly close to our background color. And if we go back to the browser, we can see that looks much better. And if we click any of these articles, it's going to take us off to that URL. Awesome. So let's add the ability to actually add an item to our reading list. And we can do that with this slightly styled form. Again, nothing too crazy. We're just adding some margin top to push this form down. We have two inputs, so one for our title and one for our URL, and both of them just have some padding, a background color, and some margin right to add a little bit of space. And then we have a submit button to actually submit our form. So let's wire this up to Supabase. Now in the old world, we would have had to add an onSubmit handler here, calling some function like handleSubmit. This would take an event as a parameter, which we would immediately call preventDefault on, just to stop the web working the way that the web works. And since this onSubmit is an event handler, we would need to make this component a client component by saying use client at the top of our file. And this will ensure that it hydrates with client side JavaScript, blah, 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 but not anymore. So let's remove this use client statement. And then we can make this function a server action by saying use server. And this will now just magically run on the server, meaning that we don't need event handlers, which means it doesn't need to be a client component. And so we can remove this event.preventDefault. And now rather than getting passed an event, our server action gets passed some form data, which is of type form data. And we can get our title by calling formData.get and passing it the string title. But we can also fancy this up a little bit and instead create an object from entries. We can then pass it our form data dot entries, which is a function. We can then destructure any of the fields that we have an input for, so title and URL, but we get to do it in a handy dandy little one liner. So now we can await a call to Supabase to say from the readings table, we want to insert a new reading with our title and URL. And because we're using await here, we need to turn this into an async function. And then we can tell Next.js that we've performed some kind of mutation and we need to refresh the data by calling revalidate path, which is a function that comes in from next/cache. And then this takes in a path. So in this case, we're just going to do slash, which is our landing page. And lastly, rather than this being an onSubmit handler on our form, we want to use the action prop. And now if we save and go back over to the browser, we can refresh and test this is working with a test title and a test URL. And click save, and we'll see our new test record appears in the list. Yay! And that's the first method for how we can trigger these server actions. To show you the second option, let's add a mark as read button to each of the items in our list. So back over in our code, after our link, which is printing out each of our readings, we're going to render a button. The text for this one is just going to be the checkmark emoji. And now we can specify a form action prop, which is set to a function that we want to call. So in this case, mark as read. And then we can declare this function above. It's actually going to be very similar to this handle submit. So let's just duplicate that one. But this one will be called mark as read. We're going to need an ID. And so we'll sort that out soon. And then we're going to await a call to Supabase from the readings table But rather than inserting, we want to now update. And the column we want to update is underscore red. We want to set this to true. And we only want to do this where there is a match on the ID column and that ID we're passing across here. So this is conceptually what we're trying to do. When we click this button, we want to run this function, which marks the reading as read. But this form action prop implies we're submitting a form. So we need to wrap our button in a form element. And now to get this ID passed in with our form data, it needs to be in an input within our form. So we can say input and we can set the type to be hidden. And so this means this input field won't actually show up in the UI. We can set the name to be ID and the value to be our reading.id. And so now if we go back to the browser, we can see our new button for each of our items. And if we click this one for test, it disappears from the list. And that's because in our code, we're only actually selecting the readings where isRead is set to false. So this is working correctly, but it looks pretty similar to our first option here. Really, we've just moved this action prop from the form down to our button. So why would we want to do it this way? Well, this button doesn't just submit the form, it now dictates where the form is submitted to. So this form could still have its own action. So let's set this to default action, and then we can declare that one above by just duplicating this one and setting its name to default action. We then don't actually care about this form data, and we can just get rid of all of this and just console.log sent from default action. And then we can declare a new button with the type of submit, and this one is going to be responsible for actually submitting the form. And now if we save this and go back to the browser, let's create another test record. And then when I click submit, this test record isn't going to disappear from the list. And if we have a look at our server console, we can see sent from default action. So when we click this submit button, this form is being sent to this default action function. So this one that just console logs out our message. But if we click our other button, it's marking our reading as read. So we can confirm this is still working by coming across here and clicking our tick, and then test disappears. Excellent. And that's how we implement option 2 of server actions. Now, something to call out here is both option 1 and 2 give us progressive enhancement out of the box. And this means if JavaScript is disabled or fails to load for whatever reason, our form is still going to work and our server actions are still going to run. Everything we've implemented so far happens on the server, and so we don't actually have any client-side JavaScript yet. So let's get some client-side JavaScript running and up the stakes. But firstly, I'm just going to comment out this button and just add a little bit of styling to our form here to give it some margin left and also make it inline. And now this looks much better with our markers read buttons sitting alongside each of our items in the list. And so now let's look at the third option for calling a server action, which is manual invocation. And so this is where we can choose when we want to call this function with JavaScript. So this could be in like an event handler in a client component rather than just being from submitting a form or clicking a button. And so we're going to add another button here, which we're going to use to upvote our resources. So let's start by adding this column to our query from Supabase. So here where we're specifying ID, title, and URL, we also want to get back our upvotes. And then we're going to chain on a dot order so that we can sort our results by that upvotes column. And we're going to set ascending to be false. So the one with the most upvotes will appear first. And to implement the upvote functionality, we're going to declare a new server action called handle upvote. And again, this will be an async function. This one will explicitly take an ID, which is a string. And we're going to make this a server action by declaring the use server statement. And then we can await another call to Supabase, but this time we're going to use RPC. And so RPC just allows us to call a Postgres function from Supabase.js. And the reason we need to do that here is because incrementing that upvotes column is actually 2, maybe 3 statements in Postgres. First, we need to select the current value for upvotes. We need to increment it by 1, and then we need to write it back to the column for that particular row. So we can wrap all of this up in a Postgres function and just call it with this really simple API from Supabase.js by just saying RPC and then giving it the name of our function. And so in this case, that's upvotes. We then just need to tell it which ID we would like to increment the upvotes for. And so that's this one that we passed into the function. And lastly, we want to call that revalidate path function for our landing page. And so now we can render out our client component, which is going to actually run this function. And so that will be after our markers read button. Our client component is going to be called upvote. It's going to take an ID prop, which is set to our reading.id, a upvotes prop, so that it knows how many upvotes to display. So this is going to be set to our reading.upvotes. And then we have our handle upvote prop, which is set to our handle upvote function. And so now we need to actually create this client component for upvote. And so we can do that here under the app directory. We'll have a new file called upvote.tsx. And then here's one that I prepared earlier. So again, it takes our three props. So our ID, our upvotes to display, and then our handle upvote function to increment that value by one. And then we're just rendering out a button, which when clicked is going to call that handle upvote function and pass it our current ID. And then we're displaying a nice little up emoji and then our number of upvotes. And so now back in our server component, we can import this client component from .upvote. And now if we save this and go back to the browser and refresh, we can see we have these nice little buttons to increment our value. And if we click it, it increments. And because of our sorting, it's now jumped up here, but we can click it again and increment again and again. And we can increment this one and we can make this one jump above this one. So much fun. But the cool thing is, now that we're over in JavaScript land, we can do anything we want. We could disable this button while we're actually updating that value, or we could implement an optimistic UI pattern so we could update the value for upvotes as soon as we click the button. So let us know in the comments if that's an example you want us to put together. If you want to go deeper with the Next.js app router and learn about authentication and authorization, I recommend you check out this video right here. We implement cookie-based auth from scratch that's available across both the client and server components. But until next time, keep building cool stuff.